with us too. Wherever you are, we're glad you're here. We're glad you're able to join us today. We're going to worship God. We're going to talk about what it means to be courageous today and how we can become courageous men and women of God living in a world that sometimes is not always friendly to us. So as we do that, let's focus our attention today upon Jesus Christ, because that's exactly how we become courageous, because I can't think of anybody in this world that's ever lived in this world that was more courageous than he was. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, this morning we come before you thanking you that you in your Son reveal to us how we can be men and women of phenomenal courage by focusing and practicing that which is true, as we talked about last week, things that are genuine, things that are real. We can focus on things that are real and genuine and not the false stuff that our world offers us. And thank you also that we can talk today about what it means to live an honorable life, what it means to be honorable, to focus on honorable things and to practice honorable things. God, help us to build that desire within us so that we can indeed be courageous people. Today, Lord, we come before you in humility, because we know that in ourselves, in our flesh, there's no good thing. But because of Jesus Christ, you dwelling in us, we have the possibility for every good thing. And it's all available to us through you. And we praise you and we lift your name on high and we offer you adoration and praise right now. And we will through our singing and through our worship and through our learning and through our giving and through our practicing of the Eucharist and the communion service this morning. God, honor yourself in this place today and honor Jesus Christ, we pray. In his name, amen.
Stand with us. We're going to sing Build Your Kingdom again. We're going to keep working it.
Hi, Cindy.
Come set your rule and reign in our hearts again. Increase in us, we pray. Unveil our main. Come set our hearts ablaze with hope, like wildfire in our very souls. Holy Spirit, come invade us now. And we are your church, and we need your power in us. We seek your kingdom first. We hunger and we thirst, refuse to waste our lives, for you're our joy and prize. To see the captive hearts released, the hurt, the sick, the poor at peace, we lay down our lives for heaven's cause. And we are your church. Your kingdom's power, reaching the near and far. No force of hell can stop your beauty changing hearts. You made us for much more than this. Awake a kingdom seed in us. Fill us with the strength and love of Christ. And we are your church. The hope on earth. Build your kingdom here. Let the darkness fear. Show your mighty hand. Fill our streets and land. Set your church on fire. Win this nation back. Change the air. Build your kingdom here, we pray.
next one is the one that Chris wrote. And listen to the words. You know, this is a life, this song speaks within a life of Christ. But if you're looking for Jesus today, listen to the words. You know, if you're a born-again Christian, it relates to you. If you're not, choose him today. So, sing the song with us.
My God, you are so wonderful, this I know. Your majesty is revealed in the smallest things to me. I'm raising my hands, declaring to make a stand, that you are my King, mighty to be for me. Yes, I declare that you are my King. Yes, I declare you won't forsake me. And now I know that I am free. I'm living proof of liberty, not shackled by the past I've lived, but deemed useful for the God that gives. I say hallelujah. You say hallelujah. We say hallelujah.
Look it out.
We say hallelujah. So you out there, do you want this freedom for yourself? My God, is standing there with arms open wide. He overcame death to let you walk by your side. Invite him in, don't let this time pass you by. Yes, I declare that you are my King. Yes, I declare you won't forsake me. And now I know that I am free. I'm living proof of liberty, not shackled by the past I've lived, but deemed useful for the God that gives.
Yeah.
I say hallelujah. You say hallelujah.
I'm still here. Just me. So this next song is called As the Deer. This has been a favorite since I was a little kid that we used to sing in California. I think this life talks about a journey. And for me, lately with Dad's sermons, I've found a new path that I've had to walk on my Christian life. A new integrity about that I've been challenged on of behind closed doors Christian walk, that not just the Christian walk that you all see
but my personal relationship with God, that do I yearn for God? Am I in love with God? Do I need God as much as I tell other people that they need God? And that's been a real challenge for me. And then this song, it's just going to be me and my voice that I'm going to be singing. Listen to the words. If you want to sing it, sing it if you know it. Or just have this be your prayer to God right now. And I hope as I sing this song that you fall in love with Jesus again. And that you clear out all the junk that you receive in the week. And just listen to the words. And prepare your heart for the sermon. This goes, I think it goes really well with what Dad's getting ready to speak about. As the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after thee. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. You're my friend, and you are my brother, even though you are a king. I love you more than any other, so much more than anything. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship thee. I want you more than gold or silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart desire, and I long to worship thee.
Father God, as we continue now in prayer, we've been singing in prayer, and now we're going to continue in prayer. Lord, we really need you. We need you to touch our affections and make us sensitive to your Spirit's work in this time. In these next few minutes, would you please identify and soften those places in our lives that are hardened and not sensitive? And would you identify those places that are sensitive, making them even more sensitive, so that we can respond to the Spirit's call in our lives, in our relationship, not only with you initially and most importantly with you, but secondarily and of secondary importance with everyone else. Change our lives, Lord. We need to be men and women of courage, and you provide us with everything that we need to be able to be that. And let us worship you, because even though you are a king, you're also our brother, Lord Jesus. Yes, you're our Savior, but you're our friend as well. Yeah, you're our master, and we're your servants, but you've also said that we're your friends, your closest allies. for certainly you are our closest ally. Thank you for what you've done for us. But thank you for what you're doing for us and making us men and women of courage. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. The past few weeks we've been talking about this. This, I think, is the third week we've been talking about it, but this is a subject, living a courageous life for our Lord. In the past, we found that the biblical courage is this concept right here, to courageously press forward into life through faith in God's gifts and strength and motivated by His love, persevering regardless of fear or personal weakness. No matter what comes at us, we keep plugging. We may slow down, we may even stop from time to time, but we keep plugging. Overall, we're continuing to move through life with courage. Not that we're not afraid, not that we feel like we can't do it, but we continue to do it regardless. And we talked a few weeks ago about these three pillars. The first pillar is the one we've been talking about last week and this week, and we will for the next few weeks, because this pillar, if you will, has eight sections to it, and we're just on the second one. And as we look at these eight sections, we focus on them, and then we practice those things. The second pillar is we acknowledge and use God's gift, and the third one was we worship God in our body, and we pursue God with our whole self. And that's where we've been, to get courageous. Those are the three pillars for having a courageous Christian life. Last week, we talked about focusing on and practicing what is true, and this week, we're going to talk about focusing on and practicing that which is higher. The Word of God says, finally, brethren, whatever is honorable, dwell on these things. The things you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. Whatever is honorable. And the word literally means that it kind of makes you step back. It's like you're in the presence of somebody that's just radically different, and you're kind of in awe about the way that this person who is honorable lives. What does being honorable really mean? Well, here's what it really means. There's three other places besides the passage that I just read where the word shows up. Here it shows up as the word dignity, that deacons, those who are servants or waiters or waitresses in the church, must be men of dignity, not double-tongued, nor addicted to much wine or fond of sordid gain, but holding to the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. That's what Paul says to Timothy that deacons are to be. Women also, he says, likewise must be dignified, not malicious gossips, but temperate, faithful in all things. And then it shows up again as in regard to elders or older men. We too are to be temperate, dignified, sensible, sound in faith, in love, and in perseverance. So those are the three, that's only four times in the whole Word of God that this word actually shows up. It doesn't show up anywhere else other than these. And there's the Greek word. It's called semnos. That's how it's pronounced. And it means basically a life that's not lived by the senses. Now think about that for just a minute. A life that's not lived by the senses of taste, touch, sight, smell, or hearing. As I was studying for this and I looked at this word, all of a sudden I realized this is really challenging. Friday, I had to go to Charleston, and after I finished up with my meeting, I was hungry. It was about time for lunch, and I kept trying to think, okay, where am I going to go? And I don't want to take the time to drive way out to Quarter G to one of those nice restaurants out there, and I don't want to stop and just get a cheeseburger at one of the fast food places. And I realized that I was only a few moments from Krispy Kreme. So I went into Krispy Kreme, and you know that Krispy Kreme does not at all appeal to your higher senses. It appeals to your taste, your sense of taste. And I drove down, got off the interstate, and turned down McCorkle Avenue, and I looked, and as I got, I was peering and around the corner, hoping, and yes, the red sign was on. And I pulled in the lot, and I stopped, and I went in, and I got 2 dozen donuts and a cup of coffee. And when I left, I had 1.5 dozen donuts. You see, they appealed to my sense of smell and my sense of taste. And I consumed vast quantities of caloric intake. And then I proceeded to come home, and when I got home, I took a picture of those donuts, the ones that were left, and I sent them to Bob, and I said, something like, na 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 boo boo, you can't have any. And then it started a long tirade of text messages back and forth between he and I over the course of the last hour. So Bob and I are going to be making a run to Charleston pretty soon to get a dozen and kill a dozen right there in the restaurant. Right, Bob? And then I thought about, I go around our house, and Terry's got these little things sitting in the bathroom and sitting in the kitchen and sitting in the living room and sitting in the bedroom, and they've got a little bowl and little sticks coming out of it. Aroma, sense of smell. We like to smell sweet things. We like to have, I had my robe on this morning, and my robe is really soft on the inside. It's just really, really soft on the inside. And we like things that are soft. We like things that are, you know, that are warm. And when we go outside, we like to have, we guys like to have a nice heavy Carhartt jacket on because it's going to keep us warm. And we like these kind of things. We are drawn to live life by our senses. And the Apostle Paul is challenging the Philippians here to dwell on, to think about, to consider deeply, to meditate on, to ruminate on, to contemplate, okay, what's higher than just sense perception? What's higher than just that which makes me feel good right now? What's higher than that? What's better than that? There's something else, and that is honorable. Whatever that is going to be honorable because it's not just something that we go for with our base senses. It literally means a mind and heart that's opened and focused upon what is noble, what's worthy of reverence or respect, and it's a heart that's seeking what's serious or solemn. Now, let me tell you right off the bat, this doesn't mean that whoever is a person of honor or dignity is a stick in the mud and always grumpy and never smiles and is always real serious about everything. It doesn't mean that, but it means that their heart and their mind is focused more on those things. It also means that pursuing only that which has genuine value in life, pursuing those things that are the most genuinely valuable. What it comes right down to is this: it's living by a higher order. It's choosing to live by a higher order than the average order of the world. And that average order is to live by taste, by touch, by sight, by smell, by hearing. How do they try to sell stuff to you on television, ladies? They'll sell makeup for 60-year-old women, and they'll have the audacity to put a 25-year-old girl up there as though that makeup is going to look the same on that 25-year-old girl as it's going to look on a 60-year-old. Guys, they'll sell you Viagra. Go ahead. Wait, I know this is kind of a touchy subject. And they'll show a guy with hair about my color, and he's walking around with a girl that looks like she's 2 or 3 days older than 18 years old. Hello, they're appealing to your senses. They're appealing to your senses. Why do they put a girl beside of a car, a sports car? You get the car, you get the girl. It's all about our senses. Everything about marketing is about senses. It is about our sense lifestyle. And the Word of God is challenging us. Apostle Paul is challenging us. There's nothing wrong with your senses. There wouldn't have been nothing in the world wrong with me stopping and getting some Krispy Kreme donuts. What was wrong was I took a picture of him and sent him to Bob and told him he couldn't have any. And it was wrong also that I ate 6 of them at one time. Maybe. Well, it turned out later on in the evening it was really a bad decision. There's more here. Honorable is this concept of focusing on what's truly valuable, not just on what feels good right now. When I went into Krispy Kreme the other day, I was focusing on what feels good right now. I was hungry, and these things taste good, and the coffee was good. I'm going to grab one. But this honorable life is a life that focuses on what's truly valuable, not what feels good right now. There's an orderliness that comes to life for this woman or man. There's an orderliness that affects both the attitude inside and the behavior outside of a person. It changes them inside and out. This whole idea of you notice in this person a noble seriousness and a consistency and a quiet confidence in God that simply pours out of this person's life. Not at all. Not at all. This person is not at all too serious, condescending, smug, or critically severe with other people. Not at all that kind of person. This honorable person is relinquishing of eternal matters to the Spirit of God instead of pressuring people. They're patient. How many times have you been to church at a church and they give this message and then they give the invitation and then the pastor gives a second verse and a third verse and a fourth verse and a fifth verse and a sixth verse? And before long, I have been to church before to where the pastor kept talking during the invitation to where he kept saying, well, now if you're here today and you have this problem or that problem, you need to come forward. And before long, he gave a reason for everybody in the church to be down front. What was he trying to do? We've tried to get people to make a move because pastors like to see people make those kind of moves, walk down front. It makes a pastor feel all woohoo. That's why I don't have an altar call, because it doesn't matter how I feel. What matters is whether our lives, mine and yours, are changed. What is that appealing to in pastors? Having to have, now did not say that all altar calls are wrong. I'm not meaning that. But when it goes on and on and on, all of a sudden, guess what? I'm not leaving eternal matters up to the Spirit of God. I'm going to be the Spirit of God, and I'm going to get these people made right. All of a sudden, I'm not patient with people anymore. Pressuring people, constantly pressuring, put pressure on people constantly. I never forget as a young man, I was working a job at Tradewell, and I kept getting a call. I missed church on Wednesday night because I had to work, and I'd always get a call from this one lady at church, and she'd always say, you know, Mark, we really missed you at church on Wednesday night. And I'd say, oh, I'm glad you missed me. Thank you very much. Well, now, when are you going to repent and get right and get back in church? And I said, well, ma'am, I'm sorry, but I had to work Wednesday night. I worked down here at the grocery store. Well, you can get your schedule changed around, you know. And I said, no, I can't. My schedule is set by somebody other than me. Oh, well, you need to be in church. I said, I agree. Constantly putting pressure on people. Folks, we need to be patient. And this person, this man, this woman, who is an honorable person, they're not trying to do the work of the Spirit of God in a human being's life. They're going to be patient with them. A quiet trust in the sovereignty of God in all things, with all people at all times. No matter what happens, there's a quiet trust in the sovereignty of God in regard to everything. A humble willingness to endure the opposite in others. If somebody else is not quietly trusting, somebody else is pressuring people, somebody else is inconsistent, it doesn't matter. You know what? There's just a humble willingness to be patient with people who don't enjoy the same honorable lifestyle, the same higher choices that this person does. They're not condescending and smugly talking about it. Bottom line is, when I see this person, I'm filled with admiration, respect, and appreciation for this woman and man, and I want to emulate it in my life. I want to see some of that coming out of my life. Simply put, being honorable is being like Jesus. That's exactly how Jesus lives with us. When was the last time that you read the New Testament scriptures and Jesus Christ put pressure on somebody? Can you find it in the scriptures? Can you find it in the scriptures? You can't find it. You can find him going up to somebody that claimed to be a religious guide, a person who was a leader of people to God, who wasn't really leading people to God, and he'd go up to them, and he'd look at them, and he'd say, you're a hypocrite. But he's not pushing people. What did he do? He spoke the truth to them, right straight to them. But, you know, it's always amazing to me how tough he was on those who were religious, but how gentle he was with those who were not. It's very patient and very understanding. It's living out the gospel of Jesus Christ. We talked about this last week. Jesus' life describes two vital realities. Number one, what it means to be truly human, and number two, what it means to be truly alive. And I don't believe I can be truly human. And I can't be truly alive unless I'm reaching for that higher style of living. It doesn't mean that I'm better than other people. It means I want something different. I want something different. I want to live in a different way. Here's basically what this means. We've talked about these things before. When I'm living by my senses, taste, touch, smell, when I'm living by how I feel right now, I can get very indifferent to people when the Word of God challenges me to love people. I can become very treating people, giving them what they deserve rather than living with them according to mercy. I can start making people try to earn my acceptance and my love and my respect and my appreciation rather than giving it to them out of grace. All of a sudden, I become a very willful person, and I move into people's lives very willfully instead of the quiet willingness in my life. I'm no longer a simple person. I'm a very complex person. And life in my life and in the life of those people who are around me is very complex instead of very simple. And all of a sudden, when I'm not pursuing this kind of life, wealth becomes a big deal to me rather than living in poverty the way that my Lord Jesus lived. Not only that, but power becomes a big deal to me. I have to have power over people. And instead of being powerless and letting God be the one who has the power, pride becomes a really big deal rather than humility. Superiority over people rather than minority to them. The bottom line is the person who is pursuing honor, the higher style of living, ends up being a person of minority rather than a person of superiority. Instead of being tentative and scared and holding back, there's an abandonment toward God and an abandonment toward people. Not only that, but instead of sticking with status quo and staying the same way, there is a transformation that consistently takes place in that person's life. The confusion is replaced by peace. This is what we've been talking about. These are the 12 realities of life that we've been talking about. The gospel, living these truths out. These things that we've seen in Christ. All of these things that we've seen in Christ, we want to live those things out in our own lives. And that, my friends, is not living by our senses. That's living by a higher standard. And that's what we're called to. You see, the person who is seeking after that which is honorable or dignified, he or she is seeking after that which is higher than just the senses, is like this: is a person who, like God, the person becomes a partner with God, because that person begins to believe and begins to understand that God really does perceive and conceive of something beautiful in them. God can really, you really begin to see after a while, when you start pursuing this, God really does see something beautiful in me. There's something, he's going to create something beautiful in me. I don't know how, and I don't know what it is, and I don't know what it's going to look like. But I really see that now. Not only that, but he has given me real life. My life is different now. After Christ, my life is different. There's a steadiness to it. There's a consistency to it. I don't always feel grand and glorious, but I have a consistent calmness about me that I know that God is in charge and he's working things out for his best interest. And there's a movement in my life that God's doing toward peace. He's conceived of something beautiful in me. He's providing me with real, genuine life, and he's moving me toward peace gradually more and more and more. And then, because of that, I'm a partner with God as a person pursuing this higher way of living. Because guess what? If God's doing this with me, yesterday evening, Terry and I were having dinner down in Huntington at this new hamburger joint. We've been there several times now. Apparently, Terry likes it real well because she keeps bringing it up. And as we were sitting there, I look out the window, because there's windows all along, and I looked out the window, and here come them walking at us this way. I said, "Terry, here comes Russ." And Russ is walking down there, and he's got this look on his face. He smiles, but you can tell there's like something going on up in here. And he's walking. He's a man with a purpose. He's a man with a purpose. And he turns and walks in the building, and I'm kind of going like this, because they're sitting right there by the door. And he's a man with a purpose. He didn't see anything. And he walks through and he walks down, and I holler, "Hey, Russ!" And he keeps walking. "Hey, Russ!" And he keeps walking. And then I realize he's going to the bathroom. he was a man with a plan. And he was on his way back there. And every time I could see, I looked at his face. And every time I see Russ, I just, you know what, I can tell that God's conceiving something beautiful in this guy. I don't know what it is. And I know, just like the sun's coming up tomorrow, guess what? He's going to get in the way of it. But you know what? You know why I know that? Because I got in the way of it too. But here's the other thing. I really do believe in the sovereignty of God in Russ's life. God's going to win because God's got a plan, and God's God, and He's sovereign, and He doesn't never not win. He doesn't ever lose. He's always sovereign. So Russ goes, he comes out, and he comes walking back through there, and I holler, "Hey, Russ! Hey, Russ!" And he didn't hear me again. I'm thinking, boy, this guy is really in the zone. And he walks out the door again, and I throw my arms up and go, "Hey, hey, hey," and he sees me. He comes walking back in, and we stand there and talk. I said, "What's going on?" He goes, "Oh, my mind's just going." I said, "Ah, man, I can tell. Yeah, I can tell. His mind is just going." He said, "I got a lot of decisions to make, and a lot of things are going on." See there? God's conceiving something beautiful. And there's real life there. And I can participate in that. And in you too. And you in each other. Us in each other. And I can move somebody toward peace. Why? Because God's moved me toward peace. I don't have to respond impatiently. I can respond with peace. I can just be simply chilled out. This is being a partner with God, because God does these three things, and then He partners together with us to use us to be a part of bringing these three things into the lives of other people. And we don't even know it's happening until we start pursuing that honorable way of life, that higher way of life, a way of life that is separate just from living according to our senses and our sensations. Christ-likeness, not egotism. Humility, not pride. Other-centeredness, not self-centeredness. Our struggle, however, is this. We have a struggle with conforming to our culture. And our culture, the Word of God says, do not be conformed to this world. What is our culture? Our culture is a culture of conforming to something that will massage one of those five senses that we put up there. Buy the soft clothes. Buy the tasty meal. Buy this. Buy that. And it's all something to do with our senses. Buy the cool-looking car. Buy the cool, go get the cool-looking hairdo or the beautiful hairdo. How many times do I see something about stuff when you get to be my age? There's all kinds of stuff pops up on the computer. And I don't know why they keep doing this, but every day there is this, I get this thing, it says 12 cute haircuts. And it's got a picture of a woman, so it's talking about women. 12 cute haircuts that'll take 15 years off your life, off your appearance. And it's for women. Here's even a haircut that appeals to your senses. A haircut that appeals to your senses. This is what our culture is all about. Don't be conformed to this culture, he says. Our struggle is also this right here. Our values affect our heart. Notice what Jesus said. Where your treasure is, there your heart's going to be. Where your treasure is, that's where your heart's going to be. And we're stuck in this, aren't we? This becomes life to us. The last thing, not only the conformity in values, but this whole idea of what we esteem. Notice this passage of Scripture. Knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from a futile way of life handed to your by your forefathers. We focus on a way of life that's been inherited to us from our families or from our communities and from our church community and from those that we live in. We become challenged by, we become changed by our environment so much, and our environment makes more change in our lives sometimes than our God does. Because what we allow to change our lives will change us. But we have this futile way of life that's inherited from our forefathers. Or we can live according to that which has been done for us, that we've been redeemed by the precious blood of a lamb, unblemished, spotless, the blood of Christ. This is higher. You must see this. You understand this is higher. When I'm truly human, when I'm truly alive, in other words, when I pursue honorable or higher living, the bottom line is I become courageous. My life changes. I become courageous. Why am I courageous? Because I'm living by a set of values, and people look to me and they find something valuable in me. They'll find it in you. There's some of you that I look at your lives and I see things of value in your lives. Why? Because you're pursuing something that's more honorable. Not the baser things of life, but the more honorable, the higher living things of life. You're a courageous person. And when I look into your life, I see something there of value in me. Not only that, there just comes an orderliness to life. A calm orderliness to life and a confidence that we haven't had before. There is a real nobility that happens, and you don't even know you're that way. People, I see it in you. I see it in you. I see it in you. Reverence. There's an awe and a reverence toward God and a reverence toward life that wasn't there before. A consistency and a patience and a trust in God and a trust in God's work in other people's lives. And a willingness that replaces that contrary, stubborn willfulness. We need to focus and practice on what's good. How do I become honorable? It's real simple. The Word of God says that, first of all, in Philippians chapter 4, verse 8, first of all, I'm supposed to dwell on it. Second of all, I'm supposed to practice it. What does dwell mean? Well, dwell means I'm going to look for it. I'm going to look for honorable living in you and you and you and you and you and you. I'm going to look for honorable living in you. Now, I'm looking for it, not so I can critique it and judge it and criticize it, but so I can see it, I can understand what it means and what it's like. That's why the Apostle Paul says, the things that you've heard and seen in me, practice these things. Paul's not conceited. Paul understands that for me to know what it means to live an honorable life or a life by a higher standard, I'm going to see it lived out in somebody else. So he says, dwell on it. I'm going to be looking for it and practice it, which basically means I emulate it. I repeat it. I do it myself. Somebody asked, one of you texted me this week and said, how do I change? And I said, you simply repent. You simply confess your sin and you change. You don't do it anymore. I can't seem to change. I said, relax. Take it easy. It's God's job to change you. It's not your job to change you. It's your job to be obedient. You simply confess your sin and ask God for the strength to be able to repent, to change, to live a different way. The bottom line is I look for right living, and then I go about emulating it in others. To dwell and to practice, to look for it and to emulate it. You know what this is? Real simple. It's all about desire. It's all about desire. I'm going to stop for just a second. I'm going to go from preaching to meddling, because the church has made the word desire bad. The church has made the word desire bad. But even those that are called into full-time ministry, the Apostle Paul says these words to Timothy, if a man desires the office of a bishop, in the King James Version, if a man desires the office of a bishop, it's a good thing. It's a good thing. So desiring is a good thing. There's nothing wrong with desiring. And my desire is revealed by me looking for what I desire in other people and then beginning to emulate it and not getting worried with the fact that I mess it up sometimes, that I don't do it as well as I would like to do it. It reveals desire. There's nothing wrong with desire. Don't shut your desire down. Don't be afraid of your desire. Instead, take it to God and ask Him. Look at it and then emulate what you see that is right. Bottom line is, what I desire is what I'll acquire. What I want the most is what I'm going to get the most of. If you live this life so that you can have a pocket full of money, you'll have a pocket full of money. Because if you really want it that bad, you'll work hard and you'll save and you'll have that money. If your whole life is wrapped up, men, I am going to have a woman, guaranteed, you'll have a woman and you'll probably have women. Not just woman. And ladies, the same thing for you with men. If you desire that which is higher, listen, guys, God desires it for you too. You're going to get there. You're going to get there. Focus and practice what's higher. Focus and practice on what's higher. Don't focus and practice on the things that are of the senses, because those things come naturally. We're just good at that naturally, and we live in a world that just draws us to that. Let's focus and practice on what is higher, and let our desires be set on things above, as the Word of God says, rather than things beneath. This is going to take us to being men and women who are truly courageous. And I want to finish with this. There has to be a path toward receiving this life. And I think this is it. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. If there's not been a point in your life where you have bowed the knee to Christ and said, I can't save myself, I need you, there needs to be that time in your life, because he's the only way, and you must accept him. Another place, Peter says in the book of Acts, in a sermon, he said, and there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven that has been given among men by which we must be saved. This is a bottom line issue this is a beginning point issue for all of us. If we've never accepted Christ as our personal Savior, if we've never turned our lives over to Christ, we need to. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. All we have to do is believe in him, and not we won't perish but have eternal life, because God didn't send Jesus to judge the world but to save the world. And the whole world believes that Jesus came to judge the world. Yet the Bible says very clearly here that he did not come to judge you. He came to save you. And all you have to do is acknowledge and believe. And if you've never made that decision before, I pray that you'll make that decision today. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for these beautiful people. Thank you, Lord, that in our lives, all of us, you're conceiving of something very, very beautiful in us. Thank you, Lord, that you're conceiving things. You've given us real life, and you're going to give us more of that real life. And you're bringing us to the point where you're making us partners together with you. Not only partners together with you in our own search for that which is higher and better and more honorable and more noble in life, but a search to bring that honor and that higher life and that nobility into the lives of other people, beginning with salvation by grace through faith in Christ. So this morning, Lord, we come to you thanking you and praising you that you can give us the kind of courage that we need to move forward in life through pursuing a life that is higher, not better than other people, but different. We're focused on things that are otherwise higher than some are focused upon. And Lord, I pray that you will help us do that, and let us become men and women of the gospel, mimicking Christ's life. And from that, drawing courage to be able to move forward and move forward and move forward and persevere no matter what comes our way. For I ask it in Jesus' holy name. Amen.